That is okay. Sorry, I see that something happened. So I can you?
Ah, apologize, Rita.
No problem yeah. for that. No problem.
It's just a recording started. It's really we are working with the. They didn't give us the host, and now we're trying to record. We have okay. your recording separately.
No problem. For that. Okay. Then if you want, I can give you the slides or I don't know. But let we start again. So I say the data set should be not only unbiased, not only large, but also useful. For instance, in this case, since each people was detected and identified, it was also useful for tracking, since each joint was connected with the joint of the same people in the previous frame and in the following frame. In order to do that, we was able also to propose a network that was able to have what we called time affinity field, similar to the part affinity field. That means the possibility to find the connection between not only two close joint, like in this case, the joint of the elbow and the joint of the hand, but also the same joint in different frame in order to provide together the detection and the tracking. This was a simple network, but useful that we used a lot. And not only useful in general, but also capable to reach the state of the art in the JTA data set, like you can see in this table, for all the measure that you can have, MOTA, the fragmentation, the IDF1, and all the other. But if we tried to put the result trained in this network in real data, like for instance, MOT 16 or also MOT 17, the classical data set that we can use to measure the result of tracking, the result was good enough, but not a lot. Thus, these are just some examples. So as I told you, we use them in real setting, for instance, in automotive in order to for self-driving car and not self-driving car for looking for the pedestrian. And also we use them for many different applications, but it was not enough. So in the last 2 years during the COVID time, we starting to think about how can we do a good synthetic data set capable to advance the state of the art in pedestrian detection and tracking, just only using only synthetic data. So not using synthetic data for augmentation or for improving the training, but use only synthetic data. This could be really useful also for the problem of privacy that I told you before. So in this 10 minutes, I would like to show you some result that actually we presented 2 days ago in the ACCV main conference, but we can try to, I try to summarize here. Amid, I have 10 minutes, is true or more or less? Or less? Huh?
Yeah, no, okay. You have 10 minutes.
Okay, I will do. So first of all, this is a joint work we did with Laura Lialtexen and the people from Munich. So we started to think about how can we create a large, very large data set with all the people. And so until now, we believe that this data set of that now is open source, so you can use if you want, that is called the MotSynth, is one of the largest that is available, at least. It's called MotSynth because the purpose of the data set was really to train a network in order to be able to achieve the state of the art in the MOT challenge and in general in detection, tracking, trajectory prediction, re-identification, and so on. So we created a really an enormous data set with many people working on that. You can see also that there are strange people doing some strange activity in here in the data set. And also we try to be realistic in the sense that we look at the field of view, the colors, the hour of the day of the mock challenge video, and try to replicate the same setting. So for instance, this is on the left is one of the video of the mock challenge 17, and this is one video of a similar setting, at least for the shape of the people in background and in foreground, as similar is the other one. As I told you, the data set should be purposive, so we created we use many different weather conditions, many different lighting conditions, viewpoints, and also a number of people very different from crowd situation to just only single person. And also with an example of variety of people, in this case are only male, but there are also the female, that have been chosen in order to have a variety of that. These are some information about the distribution of the bounding box, but also what is interesting and also the distribution, the visibility distribution along the time. So we consider more or less 100 meter of area. So most of the people was close to the camera to the distance of 10, 20 meters. The other one instead was far enough at 80, 90 and 100 meter. And okay, this is a comparison of this MOTSINT data set with respect also to our old data set and many other. We have more than 1 million of frame, but what is important, there are more than 40 million of different people shape and that are collected and annotated, automatically annotated with a 3D position, the join and also the join in occlusion. There is the instance and there is also the information of the depth. So these are some images of that. And since the time is not too much, but you can read the paper actually, we try to do this kind of experiment, training many different algorithms, some of our algorithms and other algorithms, only in the synthetic data set and use them instead in real data set, like MOT 17, MOT 20, COCO, CrowdHuman, Market 1501 or Cook 03 and so on. So just to give an example, first, people detection. We compare the YOLO, Centernet, Faster, CNN, Masker, CNN, comparison against GoCoCo. What you see here is that if you train the data only with the synthetic data, but with this large diversity of synthetic data, you find better result, absolutely better result than the same things trained with COCO. Because this is a data set that have been designed especially for this. So these are real result for the network that have been trained on the synthetic data set. Similarly, very simple experiment of re-identification. Again, a simple identification method, there are so many. So using ResNet as a feature vector extraction and just only trained with cross entropy. And also in this case, the result in mean average and precision is absolutely, or also rank one is absolutely very, very high if you train the system with MOTSINT. Similarly, if you want to do that for multiple object tracking, we're trying to compare the two different, actually many different data set method, in particular Tractor that come from the group of Munich and CenterTrack. And also in this case, the result achieved with the data set extracted with the MODSIM are absolutely better. This is a video of the result of tracking by a network that never be trained by real human. And finally, similar, I know that I have not a lot of time, but similar for semantic segmentation and tracking using comparing track CNN and MOP and MPN track, another from Laura presented last year. And again, also in this case, in many activity, like in this case, the segmentation and the tracking together was good with the synthetic data set. So since my time is becoming very short, I have some remark. First remark, you must not try to mimic too much the real contest if you want to find a good data set. I would like to share with you the experience of my student that for 6 months tried to create many data sets, as I told you, very close to the one of the MOD challenge. So MODSIM one that is not available because it's really not useful, we tried to do similar data set like MODSIM using 7 video very close to the one of MOD data set. But the result was not so good because the variety was really limited. And again, in just only 1 second, we used another method to find, to extract 3D information from 2D images. So this is something we presented in CVPR last year. And this is the architecture is this one. I have not a lot of time, but we trained an autoencoder and we trained another part of the network to compress, to extract from the image the same feature vector representing just only the joint. And so in this architecture, we trained with the join and we extracted the join. And then and so this is something we used during the training. So using the synthetic join for training this autoencoder. And then, I skipped some slides. And then we trained another part of feature extractor to be similar to the encoding part. In such a manner, at the end, at runtime, we start with the image part to arrive through the 3D information like this one. And it's working really very well in the synthetic data set, achieving the state of the art of the result. These are some real results of 3D data. So extracting 3D information in a real setting of this kind of things. And just to give an example, we used also for this real with industry or with COVID-free situation like this one, in order to find the risk of contagious between people in a real setting. But this is a final example. What's happening if we use the new real data? In general, it's working well. So for instance, these are new data, new result that you can say that we are able to understand the distance between people, different color means different distance, just only using a single image as an input as trained in the synthetic data set. But these are two fantastic examples of errors that you can rise if your model is not good enough. For instance, in our model, we didn't consider the problem of children. And thus, this small girl near the mummy, probably, is considered not a girl, not a child, but a people that is very far, because we didn't train the network with people of a different age. So a child is considered a person that is really far. Similarly, this person is a person that is in front of the window, so it's just on the reflex, but since the reflex is far, is considered a person that is very far. So what we learned? We learned that in the data set, we should have a big model, but also a model that should learn by the context and what's happened, for instance, if we have a window in front. Okay, I think that my time is over. And so I don't use this last part of my talk, but this last part of my talk was just only to say that in some time synthetic data sets are good, in many other situations are not. For instance, now we are working in pose analysis for virtual try-on. So for finding, generating a dress in a different pose. In this case, synthetic data are not working enough because we need real dress, especially for luxury fashion, that are not covered by a synthetic data set. So this is an example, for instance, of a email virtual try-on. This is for a female virtual try-on, and these are two difficult cases. So closing my presentation, just a very few points. First, data are important as techniques. So I think that in general, we in our research lab discuss a lot about techniques, but we don't discuss a lot about data. And it's important that we have a good data set, again, all the issues, especially in visual problem. Sometimes we collect only data without considering the model, like the model of the window that you say. Sometimes we need to understand which is better choice to use a synthetic or real data set. And so I believe that we should work together in order to have a good engineering issue for data set creation. Thank you very much. And I'm here for a possible question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Rita, for a great talk. We have a few minutes for a couple of questions. If anyone has a question, please just unmute the microphone.
I can stop, okay. I'm stop sharing the slide.
Okay, I have a question myself, if you don't mind, Rita. It's a very, very nice talk and very impressive result. And I'm aware of that work as well. Just my question is how far we can move with simulation, means beyond basic level vision, means how far we can go to the high level by still ignoring the real data. Means if you are talking about the more complex human physical social interaction, how much really how much high level task can be, means how much word model we can have to incorporate in the simulation and then use it for training the models.
Okay, we discussed a lot about that because from one side in many engineering problem people use simulation data also for very, very complex system, considering, I don't know, a crash test of a car, it's a complex simulation, but they use simulated data. So probably if we have a good simulator, we can also use them. In some cases, instead, it's easier to take real data, as I told you in language generation, but also for virtual try-on problem, because in this case, we have so many, we have a million images of dressing in an e-commerce system, and so we can use them because they are available. But if the data are not available and we have some specific problem, I am a fan of simulating data. Consider another example, just to finish the example of robot trajectory analysis in unknown environment. We are working a lot with habitat data set, that is a data set of real houses that is become a synthetic world where a robot or an autonomous object can move. So I think that probably what I presented today is a very extreme, only simulated data, but on the other side, using mixed reality or real data that reused in the synthetic setting should be really useful. At least I believe in that, and you can try to find some mix on this situation.
Thank you, very comprehensive response. Is there any other question from the audiences?